peace in the Middle East. Something that these days has become a bit of an oxymoron and something that every U.S. president has promised to work to achieve in recent decades. Barack Obama has been no exception to that rule, but the war in Gaza a year ago definitely didn't help him out. Actually, it did quite the opposite. But now, the Obama administration is pushing to restart those negotiations, and they're planning on solving the problem within 2 years. This was reported after a briefing. They want the Israelis and the Palestinians to settle on a border agreement within 9 months and then get into all the other details like settlements. Too bad that the controversy over the settlements is one of the key factors that are dividing the two sides. Palestinians have said that they refuse to restart these talks until there's a full freeze on the Israeli settlements. And even the Israeli foreign minister, Avigdor Lieberman, spoke out instantly against setting any kind of time limits on these talks. So I'm just wondering if the Obama administration thinks that they're kidding someone here. Well, here to discuss it with me, I have the executive director of the Jerusalem Fund, Yousef. Yousef, thank you for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
So what do you think here? Is the Obama administration doing a bit of daydreaming by setting a time limit on this issue?
Well, I don't think there's so much daydreaming, but I think they don't realize that they're suffering from what I call boy who cried wolf syndrome. Because for the past almost 20 years now of the sort of Oslo peace process that started in the early 1990s, we've been hearing this: okay, here's our deadline, and in 5 years we're going to have a state. Okay, scratch that. In 2 years we're going to have a state, and then that doesn't work, and then okay, we're going to push it back another 2 years. We've heard this before. And it really has been sort of a repeat of the same sort of failures, really on a number of different sides. But the biggest problem has been the inability of the United States to really press Israel when it needs to.
In what way? What could the U.S. do in order to press them more?
Well, I think sometimes we think about this as a sort of a three-player game with the Israelis, the Americans, and the Palestinians, but we need to really realize the asymmetry here. The United States is a superpower, and this is its region that it declares a sphere of influence over. Other superpowers or major powers in the world realize this and don't interfere. If the United States wanted to get any smaller country to do something, it could probably do so pretty easily. But it's never really been able to put the pedal to the metal. And, in the past when...
Are they unable to put the pedal to the metal?
Well, they're reluctant.
They really
need to ask why. You know, in the past, we've seen one instance where... A couple of instances, actually, where the Israelis stopped doing something that was very problematic in response to an American request. And once was during their bombing of Beirut in the early 1980s, when a phone call from Washington put an end to the bombing within a very short period of time. The time after that was when James Baker, during the first Bush administration, basically said, I'm done dealing with you guys. You're wasting my time. When you want to talk about peace in the Middle East or actually getting a settlement or having a good relationship with the United States, here's the phone number to the White House. You give me a call. That's the kind of attitude that the United States needs to have with Israel for them to get the hint that continued colonization of Palestinian land is not going to push the situation to a settlement. It's only going to make things worse. And unfortunately, the state of Israel has sort of gotten used to being spoiled by the United States and always feeling that the United States is there to support it and say yes to just about anything Israel does, no matter how egregious it is, like the war that was carried out on Gaza. And that's an attitude that needs to change and can only change by an abrupt change in tone. And unfortunately, we haven't seen that yet.
But is the U.S. in any way perpetuating more of a conflict when, like I said in this last story, how much aid that they've just signed up for the next year, but it's all in military aid. So both Israel and the Palestinians, in order to use this aid, they have to buy U.S.-made military weapons.
Right, and all money that we send abroad has to end up getting reinvested into the United States somehow. And in the Middle East, it tends to be reinvested in our military industry. And, there's no denying that that's a part of it. Eisenhower, as early as the 1950s, warned about the dangers of America's military-industrial complex. And we certainly have a lot invested in there being a war in the Middle East. And many are questioning whether or not creating peace in the Middle East is actually in the United States' interest. Because after so many years of trying, it's unclear why a country with the stature and leverage that the United States has been unable to accomplish it.
So are we saying this is a PR move? Why would they come out and make another one of these statements? Like you said, other presidents have done it too. George Bush also set a timeline he wanted by 2005 for there to be peace in the Middle East. Why the Obama administration now comes out and says, fine, give me 2 years?
Well, I think there's a realization, particularly after 9/11, the effects of which we still see as recently as, for example, the Christmas bomber that you were talking about earlier, that there is genuine outrage within the Arab and Muslim world about the ongoing dispossession of the Palestinian people. And the target that will be the state that will be targeted in response to that is the United States, because many people see them as the only player able to stop Israel from doing what they're doing, but they have not done so. So there's definitely a realization now that you need to at least placate this public opinion, this anger that we see. And the sort of facade of the peace process that we've seen, and unfortunately, since we've not seen any progress over 20 years, it's not much more than a facade, has started to run out in terms of its ability to really calm people down.
Yousef, I want to thank you for joining me, but we've just have to really take a look and try to analyze this statement coming out from the Obama administration, where they're putting a time limit on the Middle East peace process, just as many U.S. presidents have done before. And we're wondering why they think that they can get it done this time, or maybe is it just a PR move and they're actually reluctant to do it. Well, that's it for today, you guys. Tune in tomorrow, though. We're going to take a look at the latest in drone technology. And don't forget to follow my Twitter feed and to become a fan of The Alona Show on Facebook.